You're listening to the Sound Words STL podcast.
Hello, I'm John Fleming from soundwordsstl.com. I am joined by Dave Wakeling of the English Beat before his show on November 22nd at the Duck Room at Blueberry Hill. Dave, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much. I've never been in this room. I didn't know there was any more room in here for any more stuff, but there is, it turns out. A few more cupboards of stuff.
And sort of a compilation of all things St. Louis compiled.
I mean, I've been coming here for years, and you see something new every time, really, don't you? I just saw a guy with a red Harrington jacket on, which I swear I hadn't noticed before.
Yeah, well, there's a new experience every time, I suppose. But as I mentioned before, you are here with the English Beat. You have a concert tonight, and thank you very much for joining us on the podcast. Now, start off just with the English Beat. There's a very interesting background as far as the name of the band. The band was known simply as The Beat in the UK and goes by the English Beat in North America. Did that present any sort of challenges as far as whenever the band, especially when it was first getting started, as far as like the branding, as far as...
I think it helped, if anything. What a perverse accident. We were very disappointed. But Paul Collins had got the name and Bill Graham was his manager, and they had it first in America, not by long, but enough to count. So we had to come up with something else. The record company wanted The Beat UK, which was a killer to us. I'd said I'd rather not be in a group than be in anything UK. It's horrible.
Doesn't quite roll off the tongue.
I don't know. I don't even think UK does, really. I don't know. Nobody uses it. It's sort of, I don't know. So I didn't like the idea of it one bit. So we ummed and we heard. The Australian record company jumped ahead and called us The British Beat, which I actually hated just as much as The Beat UK. And we went to a diner, a deli, and I saw English muffins, which of course are not called English muffins in England, like French fries probably. And I said, what about the English Beat? They seem to like the word England here. And the marketing department of the record company went nuts. So there's something about the word English that was like, if you said British, that meant the redcoats were coming, you know. But English meant like every other person's grandfather called Peter. From somewhere
around. Sounds very fashionable, it sounds.
You know, I don't know, it's something warming about English, the word English. And I've seen it now, I've lived here 30 years and I've sort of seen that word of it, the use of the word, and what English kind of means as opposed to what British might mean. And so it was a good accident in a way. Now, purists call us The Beat, regardless, which is fine. And I've done a tour with Paul Collins. We did a double header called Two Beats Hearting as One. That was a pretty good tour. And so the fans are all pretty certain of what everything is now. There's not much confusion. I'm just facing the confusion of bringing out a new record. And if I was to bring it out in England as The English Beat, that wouldn't make much sense.
All of a sudden they wouldn't know who you were referring to.
It'd be a new group, wouldn't it? And why would you call yourself, it's like English muffins, why would you call yourself The English Muffins in England?
So you don't personally have a strong preference between the two names?
Oh, I like the name The Beat. I think it was almost revolutionary. It was that close to the Beatles, I think, that nobody had ever come close to it. And I will notice that here in America, although I didn't get to call my group The Beat, tons of radio stations and TV shows, Ari Melba's The Beat. It's been very well used over here for all sorts of different things. We sometimes make more of the word beat and just have the English bit running up the stick of the B. So it looks like The Beat from a distance.
And you mentioned before that you've lived in the United States for 30 years and you know, and the English Beat calls America home now at this point, but in the UK there is still, you know, a band going by The Beat that's being fronted by Ranking Roger,
who, just for, crew.
For those who you know, are not necessarily familiar with the band, was along with you, sort of a co-front man of the band.
That's right. He was the toaster, and really, I mean, in some ways, the chief front man. He was the. I didn't like talking to the crowd much.
He was more
singing the songs.
So at this point, do you just consider the two entities just completely separate?
Well, there have been a lot of invitations, but they haven't come to anything as yet. So for the moment, it's quite good on any given Saturday. You can hear Beat songs on two continents, you know, sure. On the bright side. The initial idea had been if he was to visit America or I was to visit England, we'd combine our efforts. But that hasn't panned out yet. And you've got managers and different agents and different musicians in the bands, and nobody wants to lose their gig. And me and Roger working together puts a question mark over everybody's head all of a sudden.
I think your gig is probably safe, but I understand for the other people, certainly.
Yes, that's right. If me and Roger were to come together, then half the musicians probably aren't working that gig. So there's some natural forces to try and prevent it sometimes. It'll happen eventually, I think. Although if he leaves it much longer, it might be too late to give up.
Yeah. So one of the biggest hits for the band was also the first single for the band, which was a cover of Tears of a Clown by Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, which is, you know, this very well-known, universally beloved pop song, but doesn't necessarily scream out like ska cover.
No.
So what was the mindset behind covering that of all songs?
We had about five songs and we were rehearsing them, and we'd play the same song for about 20 minutes, and about three of those minutes it would sound fantastic and the other 17 was like horses running for the front of the pack or four white guys building a shed in the dark. But then another 3 minute ellipse where, oh, that's it, that's perfect. We never could hang on to it, what we were trying to get. After a few weeks, the drummer, Everett, said, why don't we all learn a song that we all know for next Tuesday's rehearsal and then have a go at one of your weird ones like that mirror thing. So we spent a few minutes then having to go around to find a song that we all knew. Tears of a Clown was the first song that everybody was fully knew. So we all went back and kind of learnt it by ourselves and then played it together on the next Tuesday. And it was quite good. So we played that, then we'd play one of our songs, then we'd play Tears of a Clown again, and then we'd play another one of our songs. We tried to catch on to this groove that was kind of punky, reggae-ish, soul-ish, exciting but relaxed. And each time we did it, twist and crawl, Tears of a Clown, Mirror in the Bathroom, twist and crawl, Big Shot, twist and crawl, click, click, twist and crawl, Noise in This World. That was it, probably. Each one of them would take a bit more semblance, and the little ellipse where we'd all sit together, the groove would last a bit longer until it was lasting well over 3 minutes, which was all you needed for a pop song.
It's incredible that it came together as quickly as it did, but it certainly had staying power.
Yes, I mean, some of it's timing. How lucky to be there as punk had pulled down everything. And the record companies and the radio stations were not sure what to do next. And so they were very eager to appear hip and be on the cutting edge. Because a lot of them had just missed punk. It had come and gone, sold millions of records, and they missed it. And so in that post-punk period, if you were filling dance halls, record companies were all over you. And there was no question ever about what you were singing about. There was no questions about, like, oh, are those political, those lyrics? Just allowed to sing about what, because compared to what they'd just gone on with punk.
Anything was going to be toned down.
Anything was pale in comparison. So long as you smiled, our idea was we could be the Monkees with John Lennon in the band. So you could get on television and still be subversive. With a wry grin was the idea.
Very interesting comparison, interesting ambition to go for. Now, after the English beat, after the first run of the English beat, mm-hmm. I should say, you and Ranking Roger formed General Public, which included a lot of other notable names from that era of music. Mick mm-hmm. Jones of The Clash, members of Dexy's Midnight Runners, The Specials.
Yep.
How does a band like that come together, where you have people that already have established careers, they're already known commodities, but you're able to...
It was the oddest thing, really. Everybody was out of work. Suddenly... And although we'd all turned out to have become quite famous, we all lived really close to each other, within 15 miles of each other, everybody. So Stoker had been in the first Dexys, and Kiss Me With Your Mouth, Your Love Is Sweeter Than Wine. Oh God, what was his name? Anyway, that song was a big hit. And he was in the first Dexys, the... Gino Dexys. Mickey Billingham was in the second round of Dexys, the Come On Arlene crew. And they both lived very close. And Horace, the Specials, were now on hiatus also. And he wasn't doing anything. And to start with, it was, we'd met these people whilst we'd been in a group. And suddenly between the beat and starting up what was going to happen with General Public, we were at home and got a chance to actually meet these people at home. So it started off really with the idea, oh, it'd be great to do a song together one day, wouldn't it? And it turned into General Public. And there were other options as well, but it was good. Everything fitted together, and everybody had just been on the road or working hard the last few years, so they were all ready to go. They knew what it took to get it done, you know.
Yeah.
Which was, and then, so it wasn't a surprise for him to be back on a tour bus or that sort of thing. And then we added Mick Jones as a cherry on the top, really. That was like a barter deal. I came up with some melodies for him to put his lyrics to for Big Audio Dynamite, and he played lead guitar on the first General Public album. Well, I think he plays about on 7 of the songs. Only the ones he liked. I said, just play on the ones you like. Oh, and he did. Perfect. So that's his guitar on Tenderness. I think it adds the world to it, really.
Yeah, and many of the songs that you produced with the English beat, with the beat, whichever you want to call it, with, you know, all these different outlets that you've had, have appeared in pop culture. They've been in movies like 16 Candles, Ferris, Bueller, Day Off. A lot of, you know, particularly a lot of American audiences may have discovered the band through that.
A lot.
Yeah. I mean, how do you feel about the fact that people are discovering it through, you know, without even really seeking out necessarily new music, but they just kind of accidentally stumble upon your music?
Well, I suppose if it's been out for a while and it did okay at the time, I don't mind how people come across it after the fact. So whether it's the Spider-Man film or... the wedding scene from Clueless, if that brings them to the music and they look a bit deeper, that's pretty good. You'd wonder about it. Now, you see a lot of songs on TV commercials, and when I hear the song then, I think about the song differently. Like I think about the TV commercial. So a few songs now, which sort of... late baby boomer generation and the illnesses that they get in, and they're sort of starting to use like Fleetwood Mac kind of songs, you know, or even there's a special song for a pension fund, isn't there? Enjoy yourself, it's later than you think. And I'll bet the money's really great. When I hear the song away from that TV commercial, it makes me think of the TV commercial, and I get a bit mad about that. Sometimes I think that's spoiled the song, isn't it? But maybe in a few years that wears off, so I'm not sure. Where would you draw the line about where you would like your songs used or where you'd allow your song to be used, you know? We were all very, very strict about it, and you know, it wasn't to promote the use of violence or militarism or racism or sexism or any ism, really. And then John Cusack calls and once mirroring the bathroom for a fight scene in Gross Point Blank, and you go, sure you can. The music fits perfectly for somebody being stabbed to death with a ballpoint pen.
So, look at it.
You know, where's your line? It depends, really, doesn't it? It was an allegory. It's not really a poison pen to the heart.
it's all metaphor. You can,
yes, that's it.
Yeah. So you've teased a new English Beat album. What's the status of that record?
It's done. Just been listening to it. The mixes are done and the sequencing's done. And between now and when we get back the first week of December, or second week of December, we're listening to the tracks in the order they'll probably be presented. And it's fascinating because you'll go, oh, those vocals are a bit louder on that song than this one, aren't they? And that might be something they'll alter in the mix, or it might be something they just make a note of in the mastering, where that sort of thing gets equalised out a bit. I should say they're essentially done. The lucky bit is that it's been done in fits and bursts, really. So there's been a month or two of very intense work, and then I go off on tour, and then I just listen to it. And then we come back and we add stuff or take stuff away or fix stuff if something's wrong. And so most of the things that I'm hearing now that I say, oh, that should be turned up or that should be turned down, nobody else could give a hoot. It's really more about how the composition lays in my head, you know, compared to... But I will say, in the main part, the record, when I sing along with it, it sounds like the song sounded in my head. When you stop thinking about what instrument's doing what, it's created the mood and the pulses exactly where I felt them. So in that sense, the orchestration of it, and the engineer was really good, Berkeley lad, so you could go, what makes that noise? Oh, it's a bass clarinet, isn't it? Do you know somebody who plays that? Of course I do. Well, get him in. Perfect, you know. Piccolos, all sorts of things, sounds that I heard in my head, and you could just get somebody in, and he even had a friend who you could hum it, he'd write it down, and then the strings or the brass or the woodwind would play it. So that was lovely, to hear your own melodies sort of come to life around the vocal. And I should say it's past 99% done. It'll be mastered in the last couple of weeks before Christmas. Listen to it over the holidays. They'll probably have done two or three different reference masters by then. And pick the one we like, and it'll go into production beginning of the year with a single. One single, How Can You Stand There, for sure, in England. And we're tempted to bring that out here at the same time. And we're doing it ourselves, you know, with kind of service companies, you know, label services. So you kind of pick how much promotion you want and you're kind of in charge of it and you own the record, you know, give it to them and hope. So I'm looking forward to that bit of it, but I don't know whether we want to have two different singles running on two different continents. Is the first thing I do as a record company. So might play it simple and just have the same one come out. And then when the album comes out in March, we'd have another single come out then. And then I imagine it's going to be sold out shows and 9 singles, one every 6 or 8 weeks. Break for the Grammys. Best new old artist, if they have such a category. Best foreigner that won't go away award.
Sounds like you're ambitious for the record, though. It's
well, the show is sold out tonight. It was sold out, more or less, last night in Milwaukee. Sold out a couple of nights in Chicago. We've been playing the new songs and they're going down well. and there's a great anticipation, at least that from our own fans, for the record coming out. And the little excerpts, teasers we played on the Pledge Music site, which is still open. People have really liked them, getting a great response. The original producer of the first albums has been involved listening and giving his ideas and guidance, and he's really impressed. So really, once he said it was all right, I kind of thought, I'm done then. Everything else is just gravy. Bob Sargent says it's okay. And I crossed the hurdle of, is it worthy of being a beat record, you know?
Dave Wakeling, thank you very much for joining us on the Soundwords STL podcast. For more information on the band, check out Dave Wakeling, WAKELING.com.
Well, Facebook, that's a good one.
Facebook.
Pledge Music, there's a English beat there. Nice little bits to listen to. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice gentleman.
Thanks for listening to the Soundwords STL podcast.